Presbyterian Church. I am Elder Geoff Coleman, Chair of Property, and we sincerely thank you for worshiping with us today. We appreciate all y'all who are keeping up with your pledges. If you're visiting us from out of the area and would like to donate to the mission and ministry of the church, you may send a check to First Presbyterian at 100 East Frederick Street, Staunton, Virginia, 24401. Pastor Karen is continuing the porch visits and pastoral counseling. If you'd like a time with PK, email, text, or message her, and she will set that up. Our food pantry is open Mondays and Thursdays from 9 a.m. to noon. If you would like to drop off goods, you're particularly in need of peas, sugarless cereals, protein items. We are unable to refrigerate any goods at this time. Now, let us worship God.
Please join me in a call to worship with the 116th Psalm.
I love the Lord because he has heard my voice in my supplications. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live.
What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord.
I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your serving girl. You have loosed my bonds. Praise the Lord. Genesis 18, verses 1 through 15, and chapter 21, verses 1 through 7. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them, and bowed down to the ground, and he said,
"My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet. Rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread, that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant."
So they said,
"Do as you have said."
And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah, and said,
"Sarah, make ready quickly three measures of choice flour. Knead it, and make cakes."
Abraham ran to the herd, and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant, who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk, and the calf that he had prepared, and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate it. They said to him,
"Where is your wife Sarah?"
And he said,
"There, in the tent."
Then one said,
"I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son."
And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying,
"After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?"
The Lord
Lord said to Abraham.
Why did Sarah laugh and say, shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season. And Sarah, indeed, shall have a son.
But Sarah denied, saying,
I did not laugh.
She was afraid, he said.
Oh, yes, you did laugh.
The Lord dealt with Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time in which God had spoken to him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son, who Sarah bore him. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Now Sarah said,
God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me.
And she said,
who would have ever said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, you give us laughter, even in strange times. Let us rejoice in your mercy and your goodness to us. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts and our minds be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Brothers and sisters, when Sarah had this baby, they named him Laughed. When it says that Sarah laughed, Saka, Isaac, that's the meaning of the word Isaac. It's as if you named your child Laughter or Wishful Thinking. This is such a good story to come to us in a time such as this. Think about Abraham and Sarah's backstory. It's everyone's backstory in one way or another. You know, life not turning out the way you planned. You've had to, all of you, for years, adapt to the places on your roads that are winding, the ups and downs, the bridges out, construction. In a time and a place where marriages took place quite young, Sarah and Abraham have been together a long time. In a time and a place where offspring are not just a joy, but a necessity for the team of your tent to prosper, Sarah and Abraham have none, zip, zero. And where the promise of God's blessing seems not to have pollinated and taken root, yet Abraham and Sarah remained committed to the practice of their faith. God is good, and if not, he is still God. But then, God. If I was going to get a tattoo in my old age, I might have, but then, God, right along my arm. It was going to be a quote that we can find in a multitude of verses, where our disillusionment with, or our acquiescence to life as it is, gets turned on its head. But then, God. Man tracht und Gott lacht is an old Yiddish saying, man plans and God laughs. So here, at the end of a good life with each other, a settling into the way things are, for they are just the way they have always been, God says, Sarah, you can start knitting baby boots. God says, start doing Kegel exercises. God says, you're gonna need a bigger tent. And Sarah has a perfectly human reaction. Sarah laughs. It is so unthinkable, though it comes as a prophecy from a being of God. Sarah laughs. And we do too. When we're shown the promises of God, we say, unthinkable. And God says, I don't think that means what you think it means. We say, you're out of your mind. And God says, no, but I'm out of yours. I have gone beyond your capacity to even ask or imagine what I will do next. Oh, my goodness. Oh, God's goodness. Brothers and sisters, we should live in joyful expectation of God's next great act. Abraham and Sarah were living into hope when hope was threadbare, because they had stopped hoping for children long ago, yet they still honored their God. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. They learned how, as Scripture says, to count it all as joy. And so when these three men appeared on the horizon, Abraham engaged in what his faith had taught him to do. With no expectation of return, he entered fully into the practice of hospitality. Bless my tent with your presence. Let me get you a little water to wash your feet, a little bread to eat. He says this all so humbly, yet what he does is make a great feast for them, far from the bread and water he had originally offered. He calls urgently to Sarah to bake bread. Perhaps have two or three buns in the oven, and to prepare the best lamb at 90. Now, you or I, at 90, or 60, or 30, are not in the habit of opening our homes and our hearth to complete strangers. We are perhaps not even in the habit of a willingness to give up our pew to strangers, or our free time, or our tithe to strangers, to give and let it go, to cast our bread upon the waters. But beloved, the practice of faith is to know that God has a plan, and God is working it out, not on our timeline, but on His. And so, in the middle of a pandemic and worldwide civil unrest, where life has not turned out the way we planned, trusting in God, we practice our faith, knowing that God is birthing good out of all that is worn out and old and tired. God is bringing new life to our desert and blessing to our tent. And because of covenant, we continue to do good too. Because of and despite unrest, we will practice the hospitality of God's people to do justice and love mercy and walk humbly with the Lord our God, to receive the stranger and the sojourner, to feed the hungry and clothe the naked, and visit those in jail and proclaim freedom to the oppressed. When you are driving, welcome that rotten driver into your lane as your guest, and laugh with joy in your heart because you made in the image of God are doing the unexpected and the lovely in thanksgiving to the one who made way for you while you were yet a sinner. When you go to Walmart, acknowledge that poor hot thing greeting at the door in her mask as though she was your daughter. And she, who is anonymous to so many, will have been seen. Bring her a cold drink on the way out. Buy her a Coke, a V8. Engage in the practice of hospitality, for thereby do we entertain angels unaware. The best humor isn't the bottled joke kind. It's the absurdity of the human condition kind. It's the Sarah bearing a baby when she's 80 kind, and then naming that son laughter. It's that amid sickness and death and race wars and inanity and self-doubt about what was once important and the conviction in your soul that surely it must be the end times, we remember. We remember what God did for Abraham and Sarah in their end times. Look for the joy of the Lord in impossible signs of life, and you will, in all of your little acts of kindness, your bread and water and your fatted calves, in your tiny acts, do the bread kneading that speaks of the grace and mercy and hospitality of God. And to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all glory, now and forever. Amen.
Aware of the angels there, and quickly bowed to say,
life. We are blessed every week by her amazing gift. And as we come to prayer time, I also want to thank Geoff and Otto and George for working on the sound. So we keep fine-tuning this for you so that we can do all things well. And they were up here yesterday for hours figuring this out, and I am grateful to these men and their commitment to the church. As we come to the time for our pastoral prayer, I invite you to bring the sorrows of your heart, your joys, your laughter, your thanksgiving, and offer it all to God. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, who blesses us with joy in the midst of, who makes the impossible possible, who works all things together for good, we lift to you the cares, the dreams, and the aches of our heart. Lord, so many of us are concerned for the state of our country. We know that you can make all things whole. We pray, Lord, for everyone on all sides of this big picture, that they could see your kingdom and your dream and your wish for the wholeness of humanity. We pray for the hearts of mothers whose children have been killed. We pray for the hearts of mothers whose children serve as policemen and policewomen. We pray for the hearts of mothers who by now, at 90 like Sarah, had thought that things might finally be different. We have all of our own concerns too, Lord, on top of the pot that's being stirred in this melting pot. We pray for our loved ones who are ill, physically or mentally or spiritually. We pray, O Lord, in thanksgiving for the goodness that you have shown us even in a time such as this. We pray for your church at First Presbyterian, that we may continue to walk in your ways and pour our time, talent, and energy into the making of your kingdom. We thank you for your goodness to us, and we come before you praying as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Finally, my brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things, and the God of peace will be with you. And may the Lord of love, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now.